Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. It's my privilege to welcome you to this series on signs from Allah, history, science, and the soul in Islam. Welcome to those who are here, especially we have some guests here from Canada today, as well as those who are listening to us on the internet. The scope of today's presentation is rather broad. We'll go over an application of the theory of renewal that we proposed last week. If you recall, we went over the various theories of rise and fall of civilizations. We considered the theory of Ibn Khaldun, the theory of Toynbee, and then we looked at the Quran, and we proposed our own theory, which is based upon internal renewal, which is the only one that makes sense for Islamic civilization. We'll look at the peaceful conversion of the Mongols, which will correct so many of the misperceptions that people have about Islam. Very often, those who wish to give a bad name to Islam, they say that Islam was spread by force or by the sword. And in response, so many of us offer examples of Indonesia, or southwestern India, or sub-Saharan Africa, to convince other people that no, that was not so. Islam was spread not by the sword, it was spread peacefully. But the biggest example, the most convincing example of the peaceful spread of Islam is how Islam converted the conquerors, the Mongols, in the 13th century. A profound transformation that fundamentally altered the shape of global history. Then we'll ask ourselves how we can learn the lessons of today to education in America. As we face the challenges of today, in America, in India, wherever Muslims are in a minority, what kind of education do we need to impart our children in a paradigm that is non-Islamic? It is true we have these Sunday schools. That is not what is important. What is important is what do they learn in Sunday school? What kind of spiritual message are they carrying home? So we start out by way of introduction because in order to understand the transformation of the Mongols, we must understand the internal dynamics of Islamic civilization, which revolves around its innate spirituality. It is not the body that surrounds the spirit, as is commonly said. It is the spirit that surrounds the body inside and out. And it is the spiritual message of Islam that has been the herald for millions of people all over the world to accept Islam, to come into the fold of Islam. So we'll start with the definition of the tree of knowledge. The Prophet ﷺ was an embodiment of Allah's message. When Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu anha was asked to say something about the Prophet, she said he was an embodiment of the Quran. So he was an embodiment of that knowledge that came to him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was light himself. He was An-Nur Muhammadi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This knowledge, the tree of this knowledge is vast. It has many branches. By way of introduction for this session, we will divide that knowledge into two major branches, Ilmul Ibara and Ilmul Ishara. Ilmul Ibara, by definition, Ibara, Ayn Bayre, Ibarat, in Urdu, Ibarat. It connotes the wading of a stream. For instance, when you're walking on a road, all of a sudden you come across a stream, you need to wade through it, pass through it, you have water up to your knees or up to your waist, and you wade through it. So when you write something in prose, for instance, that is Ibara. Anything that can be described, that can be transmitted or taught in a school situation is ilmul ibara. So physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics, astronomy, medicine, engineering, all of these things come under ilmul ibara. So does philosophy, for instance. And to a large extent, mathematics, although mathematics is more cerebral than ilmul ibara. Then you have ilmul ishara. Ilmul ishara is knowledge that cannot be written down. It can be transmitted. Maybe it can be transmitted. Maybe it can be understood, but it cannot be taught. For instance, love. You cannot teach someone to love. Either it happens or it doesn't happen. The opposite of love, hatred. You cannot teach someone to hate. It happens internally. When they internalize it, they become it. That's it. That's an example. Ilmul Ishara is that knowledge that the Prophet ﷺ transmitted to the Sahaba according to their ability to carry. Each one of the Sahaba had that ability, their own maqam. And the Prophet ﷺ gave to each Sahaba according to his or her ability to carry the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given our Prophet Muhammad. He gave something to Hazrat Abu Bakr, he gave something to Hazrat Umar, he gave something to Hazrat Uthman radiallahu anhu, and to Ali radiallahu anhu, he made the gateway to his inner knowledge. That is the inner knowledge, the unspoken knowledge that cannot be transmitted, ilmul ishara. Today we are going to talk about ilmul ishara, which is in common parlance so-called Sufism. Now, the word Sufi is of historical origin. Why am I talking about Sufi or Tasawuf or Sufism? It is because it relates to the conversion of the Mongols. Remember, after the Mongols destroyed Baghdad in 1258, the classical Islamic civilization was decimated. 90% of the people between the river Indus and the borders of Turkey today, all the way from Amu Darya to Damascus and the borders of Jerusalem, were killed. The ulamas were decimated, the dams were destroyed, the libraries were gone. So what remained was the innate spirituality of Islam. The awliya Allah, who lived far away in small huts, they carried the message of Islam within themselves. The light that shone, that was given to them by the Prophet ﷺ through the transmission chain of similar pious people all the way through the ages. They were the carriers of that light, and they were in contact with the Mongols. That's the reason I'm going to talk about Tasawuf. Some definitions are in order because there is so much misunderstanding that we Muslims have that it's very difficult for us to wade through those definitions to come to terms with what it is that we are trying to communicate as to who we are. We somehow bracket ourselves as Sufis and Salafis and modernists and reformists, and so many different pigeonholes that we have of nation and race and etc. So it's important to know the definitions in accordance with the Quran. Any information, any knowledge that comes to us from the Quran is correct knowledge because it comes to us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any information that contradicts the Quran, we must reject because or at least at the very minimum, we must examine it. Ask ourselves, does it violate the knowledge that has come down to us through the divine source, the divine sources? Just a few definitions. Tazkiyah, that's the Quranic term. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that He loves those who purify themselves. Tazkiyah is to purify oneself. And the purification here refers not to the external purification, but the internal purification of the heart, so that the heart, just as for instance, you take a mirror and polish it until it becomes a mirror for the Hubble Space Telescope and are able to acquire stars of magnitude 8, the farthest star. Similarly, when the star is cleansed, purified, the heart becomes a reflector of divine light and is able to receive that light that came to us from our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the Sahaba, through the Tabi'in, Tabi Tabi'in, and through the chain of transmission of the Awliya Allah. Tazkiyah. Zikr, another Quranic term, to remember. Why remember? Because we are programmed as human beings to forget. I can give you a theory of learning, for instance, which involves both learning and unlearning. We forget. Even the roads that we take, we sometimes forget. And we have to be reminded. That's the balance of Allah made us. And zikr, which is remembrance, reminds us of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The word wali so often is misunderstood. When I make a presentation, other people, even the Hindus, they don't question you, they accept it. The Christians accept it, the Jewish people accept it, but one of our people, he comes up, raises his hand, oh, what do you mean, brother, wali? Who is a wali? It's a Quranic term. Inna ala awliya Allahi wa la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Wali is someone whom Allah loves. Please mark the words very carefully. You don't say, I love Allah. Because if you say you love Allah, Allah will test you and you cannot be successful. Someone who Allah loves. Someone who is protected by Allah. Do not say, he loves Allah. He is whatever. No, there is no such thing as he. Will come to that in a minute. Then the word fakhir. Well, you know, these days, fakhir, especially in our language, in the Urdu language, fakhir, you see the fakhirs. No. Fakhir is the highest stage before fana, wherein a human being knows that he has this utter want of Allah's grace in order to survive, in order to learn, in order to make a living, in order to exist. Very high state of being. Ibadah, another Quranic term. It has two meanings. It means worship and service. We have forgotten the service aspect of it. We emphasize only the surface level worship aspect of it. But the service aspect of ibadah is extremely important. What the love? So often we are asked, you know, I read the Quran. These people, they read the Quran, they don't know how to read the Quran. I'm talking about those who take a copy of the Quran, they go home expecting that to be like a novel, and they open it just before bedtime or something like that. They have nothing in their heart. And they come back and they ask a question in sessions like this. Well, I read the Quran, there was no love in it. Are you blind? The word Wadda is spelled out clearly in the Quran, but the word Rahman and Rahim have inherent in them the grace of Allah, compassion of Allah, Rahmah of Allah, and love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hikmah, you cannot define hikmah. People have taken a crack at it. They have tried to. What is hikmah? What is wisdom? It is not possible. It's not easy to define it. It is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Either He gives it to someone or He doesn't give it to someone. You may have 5 degrees, 5 PhDs, nothing in your brain. He may not have hikmah. Or a child who knows nothing, or a man in the street, he may be al-hakim. He may have the wisdom. It's a gift from Allah. It is not something that you can acquire. Tawakkul, that is to have satisfaction with Allah, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. In this materialist age, you see, nothing is enough. You're a millionaire, you want to become a billionaire. You're not a billionaire, well, you want to become something else. 4-bedroom house used to be more than sufficient in the old days. Now you want 6 bedrooms, 8 bedrooms. Nothing is enough for the modern man. Modern man has gone off on a tangent, on a path that is taking him to self-destruction. Tawakkul. Namely, patience, gratitude, and lastly, love of the Prophet. It's amazing how many Muslims these days shy away from even mentioning the name of the Prophet. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself says in the Quran, Inna Allah malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. If Allah Himself is sending salawat, and the angels are sending salawat, who are we, human beings, not to send salawat on An-Nuri Muhammad, who satisfied the very purpose of creation, love of the Prophet, the greatest man, if you want to look at him from a human perspective, the greatest man who ever lived. Dervish, another term. We associate dervish with being poverty. Oh, that dervish out there. Dervish is a Persian term. Dar is the door. Wish is someone who opens the door, who brings you through the door, someone who opens your heart. He is a dervish. Pir and Sheikh are both Persian words. They mean old man. In the old days, old people like myself with a great white beard or something, would they call a peer or a sheikh, because he's old. But gradually, wisdom came to be associated with age because he has graduated from the school of hard knocks, not from Stanford, MIT, or Caltech, but he has graduated. He's lived 78 years. He knows what life is all about, and therefore he has some wisdom, and he was called a peer or a sheikh. A murid, another term that we reject. Oh my goodness, he's a murid and he's a peer. Murid comes from the word murad, one who's asking for, who has a desire for knowledge. And when a murid goes to a peer or a sheikh, the first instruction he gives him is repentance. We as human beings are never perfect, no matter who it is, except the prophets. We are human, we make mistakes. The sheikh first says, repent. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. So when you raise your hands in prayer, the first thing they do is to ask, Astaghfirullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive me. And then they ask them for the repetition of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to remind him of the name of Allah. And then the word imam, these days everybody wants to become an imam. It just means a leader, someone who leads the prayer. In Islam, there is no such thing as imam. This is all historical terms. Imam is an historical term, but it's in the Quran. It means a leader. Anyone who leads the prayer is the imam for the occasion. In your home, you're the imam. No matter how great a scholar you invite to your home, you are the imam of your home. And you have the authority to lead the prayer in your home, no matter who it is, unless you give him permission to do so. So, you know, one can go on and on. The sheikhs have looked into the inner meaning of even names like Ahmed, for instance, which comes from the Ham prayer, in which there are so many different secrets. You take out the meme, what happens? You take out the dal, what happens? They have gone into it in great detail. Now, the purpose of the tasawwuf, therefore, is to cultivate love and wisdom and absolute trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and most importantly, self-control. Because Allah has bestowed us enough. That's a different subject. It's a huge subject as to describe who we are as human beings. But Allah has given us enough, which is a composite term. It's like saying a home. A home is an entry, a kitchen, a reception area, a bedroom, etc., etc. Nafs is a very composite term. And unfortunately, our mullahs have given nafs a bad term. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given nafs both the capability for good and bad. This is Quran. And the nafs, and what order and perfection we have given the nafs. The possibility of perfection bestowed upon human beings is what Allah has given us, except that when we hear these lectures one after the other, bad self, nafs can be bad or good. So let's take a crack at understanding the word tasawwuf. The goal of tasawwuf is self-realization, to know who we are. As the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man arafa nafsahu faqad arafa rabbahu." He who knows himself knows God. Not easy. It is a very difficult task. Al-jihadul akbar. Very difficult task that takes you to various different maqamat. The methodology is called the tariqa, as in Urdu or Farsi or even Arabic. Tariqa is a method of reaching to the level of self-realization. And the knowledge that you acquire through the process is irfan. Very beautiful term, very high-level term. Again, I'm not going to go into the details of the various different maqamats leading to irfan, except to point out that irfan includes knowledge, to be a witness, and comprehension. All of those terms are included in there. And then the process. So you have a goal, a method, and a process. As it is, for instance, when you write a computer program, or you design something in engineering, or you build a satellite or an airplane, it doesn't matter. The process is the comprehension. of the inner dimension of the guidance from the Quran, which is nothing but La ilaha illallah. If nothing else, if you remember that and repeat it often enough, that is wisdom. There is in wisdom, there is in light, there is everything that we are seeking for is in there. La ilaha illallah. And hence Allama Iqbal said, Khudika sirriniha, La ilaha illallah. After he, you know, if you study Allama Iqbal, for instance, the first 12, 15 years or so, he investigated different kinds of philosophies from Germany and especially Germany. And finally he came to the conclusion, the correct conclusion, Khudika sirriniha, La ilaha illallah. In other words, the secret of the hidden secret of the self is La ilaha illallah. That's what it means in Urdu. And contrary to what so many people say, the Sufis adhere to strict they observe strict adherence to the Sharia. Very important. Without Sharia, there is no tariqa. Sharia is the foundation. They emphasize that. You must observe the Sharia, the namaz, the roza, the zakat, remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reading of the Quran, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are emphasized, very important. And so therefore, in summary, the Sufi vocabulary is the vocabulary of the Quran. You're probably asking yourself, so where does the word Sufi come from? It has multiple meanings. It's a historical term. To my knowledge, the word Sufi by itself does not appear in the Quran, but I'll point out how it may appear in there. One possible meaning of Sufi is from the word saf, to mean pure, purity. Another meaning, Ashab al-Safa. These were people who used to wait for the Prophet ﷺ. As he came out of his hujra, he used to follow him around. And no matter what he did it. He sat down, they sat down. He washed, they washed. Ashab al-Safa, the people of purity, they're called Ashab al-Safa. But most probably it comes from the word suf, meaning wool, meaning the cloak that the Prophet ﷺ used to wear was woven by the hands of Fatima al-Zahra radiallahu anha. And hence is the integrative aspect of human life that is connoted by the word suf, or Sufi. You take wool, knit it together, make a cloak out of it, and who else wears it but the Prophet ﷺ. So copying the Prophet, so many of the awliya Allah, meaning those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed, they too used to wear a cloak of wool. And hence they're called Sufi. The word Sufism is a British invention, 19th century. They have invented so many terms to somehow confuse you, to give you the wrong impression of Islam, divide it up as much as possible, chop it up, and it will take you years, perhaps decades, as is obvious. Muslims have absorbed that and they fight over it. Sufi, Salafi, modernist, this, that, my goodness. And who is a Muslim? It's a British invented term, Sufism. There is no such thing as Sufism. There is Tazkiyah, and there is a historical term called Suf, from which comes the word Sufi, which means someone who has integrated knowledge. Now, if you look at historically, Tasawwuf has been there from the time of the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet was the embodiment of spirituality. And he gave, as I pointed out, in accordance with the ability of the Sahaba to carry it. And some who had not even met him received it through ilm al-ghayb. Hazrat al-Owaisi, who was in Yemen, is one such example. And I've shared with you in the past the example of Hazrat al-Owaisi. After the Prophet ﷺ passed away, the Prophet, this is a didactic, this is a method of teaching. So don't come back and say, where is it written? Now that's a different issue. Ilm al-kitab, and what has been translated orally. After the Prophet passed away, he asked Hazrat Ali ibn Dawano, Hazrat Umar ibn Dawano, to take his cloak and give it to Hazrat al-Owaisi. And these two set out after the burial of the Prophet, go from town to town asking people. They don't find him until somebody says, look at that man near the well. He's sitting there with a back to you, and he is al-Owaisi. So they approach him from behind, and as they approach him, Al-Awaisi says to them, "Oh, Omar, have you brought what the Prophet ﷺ gave you?" And they give him the jalaba, and he puts it to his eyes, kisses it, and then turns around, he asks Omar first, "Omar, did you ever see the Prophet?" And Omar radiallahu anhu, you know, was a man who was given to an expression of his emotions. So, "Oh, what kind of question is this? Of course I know him. So tell me something about it," was the question. And so Omar says, "Well, he was so tall, he was like this, he was a handsome man, etc., etc." "No." Then he turns around to Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, and he says, "Oh Ali, did you ever see the Prophet?" And Ali radiallahu anhu, he says, "I saw the Prophet only once, and that was above his navel and below his shoulders. And what was beyond it, I do not know." And this from a man whom the Prophet ﷺ called the doorway to my knowledge. So you see, the knowledge of the Prophet is not known to him. He gave some to everyone. What we know is not even a drop of a drop of a drop of a bucket. So, since spirituality was innate to the life of the Prophet ﷺ, it was transmitted generation after generation. But it's only towards the beginning of the 9th century that we see the appearance of the people whom we recognize as Awliya Allah, or Sufi Sheikhs. Prominent amongst them, the earliest one was Rabia Adawiya. We talked a little bit about women in Islam and what domain was open to them. One of the domains that has been open to women has been the study of the Tasawwuf. Another one, the study of Hadith. Rabia al-Adawiyya, one of the greatest of saints, the inventor of the message of love in Islam. It is said that she used to walk around in the bazaar, of course, properly clothed, and she used to say, "Oh Allah, Ya Allah, if I worship you for fear of Jahannam, put me in Jahannam. If I worship you for love of Jannah, deny me Jannah. But if I worship you for your love, don't deny me your love." She was the originator of love. And, you know, we'll talk briefly about Qawwalis and all the modern expressions of love that we have. It goes back to Rabia al-Adawiyya in the early part of the 8th century. And then after him, we see the greats such as Hasan al-Basri. This is again the 8th century. Al-Junayd of Baghdad. And Zulannun, there is the African presence. Zulannun, he was more or less a contemporary of the Prophet. A great Sufi, a great awliyaullah. People don't know about him. He was the master of ecstasy, the master of love. And he taught so many other Sahabas. Zulannun, a name that we all need to know and remember and honor, because they are part of our legacy. And Abu Yazid al-Bastami, then later al-Tirmidhi, and Hallaj, who was killed for an expression of his ecstatic love. Again, those are all specialized subjects, and I'm not going to delve into them, just to point out. Then you ask us, what? These are specialized people who were drunk with the love of God. But give me some of the examples from the area of science. You know what? Professor Sayyid Hassan Nasr, the first book that he wrote called Science and Civilization in Islam. It was a PhD thesis at Harvard. And in it he points out that Tasawwuf is there amongst the scientists. And he points out how it is that Al-Razi, for instance, Omar Khayyam, and some of the other great scientists of the classical era, they were at the same time great Sufis. How do we know that? They have written about it. So Tasawwuf was not separate from other types of ilm. It was integrated. Ilmul Ibara and Ilmul Ishara were integrated in these people. It is when we started to differentiate people that we call alim, someone who goes to a school and memorizes one book, he becomes an alim. An alim was someone who knew ilm al-ibara and ilm al-ishara, who had inherited the light of the Prophet ﷺ. That That was the greatness that they had those days. And then it became necessary to write down some of the tenets, because these Sufis were oddballs, to use modern language. And the traditional ulama always suspected them. They're outside of Sharia. They're doing something that's different. This is bid'ah. This is kufr. This is haram. This is not new terminology. If you read Imam al-Ghazali, you'll see that in al-ulum, as to what he had to put up with. They had to contend with it. And therefore, you have great scholars like Hujravi document some of the tenets of the tasawwuf. And then we have this ebullience, this fireworks, if you would, for 200 years before the advent of the Mongols of the tasawwuf. As if by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I believe, even as a scientist, that nothing happens without the grace of Allah. History, it's my deep conviction, is a manifestation of the divine will. I cannot prove it, it's a conviction. But then we must discover our future through our effort, through our ijtihad. But if you look at 200 years before the onset of the Mongols, you see these fireworks of great, great awliya appearing one after the other. I'll just point out some of them. Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani passed away in 1166. Perhaps one of the most influential awliya of all ages, whom even the other awliya who appeared a century or two after him, they refer back to him and they accept him as a sheikh. Ibn Taymiyyah himself accepts and refers to him as my sheikh. Ibn Taymiyyah, who is considered the classical Salafi writer, if you would. I'm using this term, very general term, to communicate an idea, because I do not believe in Sufism, Salafism, modernism, thisism. I only believe in the Quran. I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I'm a devout Muslim. I'm using this term only to communicate something. Then you have Al-Ghazali, who changed the orientation of Islamic civilization. He noticed how it is that, whereas the outward observances of commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, namely prayer, charity, and so on, were increasing, people did not have any spirituality in the heart. Akhlaq was going down. And hence, he emphasized the spirituality of Islam in essence. If you were to try to summarize in essence, he put the body within the soul, not the soul within the body. You know, very often people say, well, you can hurt my body, but my spirit, you cannot touch. But the spirit is outside of you, inside of you. Imam al-Ghazali changed the orientation of Islamic civilization. Such a powerful writer he was. Then Sheikh Shadhuli of Egypt, Cairo, 1257. Sheikh Suhrawardi, Moinuddin Chishti of Ajmer in India, Pakistan. Moinuddin Chishti came from Central Asia, went to Multan, Lahore, Delhi, finally entered in Ajmer. What he achieved, transformation of an entire subcontinent to Islam. Fariduddin Al-Attar, the author of Mantaq Al-Tayr. You see, when you study deeply, and I advise you, if I may, as an elderly person, every one of you must try to translate the Quran at least one single surah. No, not everyone is going to become a scholar. No, it's not going to be published. Maybe it is. Who knows? Amongst you, there may be one of the greatest scholars. But at the minimum, you'll learn the inner meaning of it. See, I'm illustrating it through the work of Fariduddin Al-Attar. He wrote the book, Mantaq Al-Tayr, which means the language of the birds. The word bird is a Sufi language. The bird is used as a metaphor for the soul, for the spirit. The language of souls. And they translate them in the conference of the birds. Yeah, the conference of the birds. Learn. It's good to learn a little Arabic and a little Farsi. And then Shah Naqshband of the 14th century. So now, having given some idea of this background that by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, history has laid out, we come to the Mongol story. In the 13th century, we went over what happened in the 13th century. All the areas, from Attock in Pakistan, to Damascus in Syria, to from Konya in Turkey, to the Amu Darya, Isfahan, Ghazna, Kabul, Herat, completely destroyed, Samarkand, Bukhara. For about 20 years, 30 years or so, this destruction persisted. And remember, the Crusades are going on at the same time. It is not commonly appreciated by our students, our scholars. They do not know history. They do not know how to juxtapose the destruction by the Crusaders with the destructions of the Mongols. This happened at the same time. Within a generation, more than 60% of the Islamic world was destroyed. And you're talking about destruction today? And yet Islam conquered. It's like a balloon, to use the words of Allama Iqbal. You compress it in one direction, squeezes out, pops out in the other direction. Islam cannot be destroyed. It will subsist because the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See how it will pop up. So for about 30 years or so, there was no answer. And then in the year 1252, the Mongol prince Baraka Khan converted to Islam. And for a long time I asked myself, how is it possible? How is it possible for a conquering prince to convert to a religion of the subject people? They had destroyed them. They had forbidden the slaughter of animals. They had forbidden the observances of some of the diktats of the Sharia, although they're considered open-minded. How is it possible? And I read in some books as I was growing up as well, this man, they call him Burke Khan. See how they corrupt names? Learn the names. His name was Baraka Khan, not Burke Khan. Burka Khan. Baraka Khan. Baraka Khan. How is it possible? Well, I read in one of the books, well, he was traveling through Bukhara and he came across a trade caravan. And this trade caravan instructed him on the tenets of Islam and he became Muslim. Come on, give me another story. Give me another story which I can believe. You think a bunch of camel drivers ride into the desert, they tell you what they believe in, and this prince in here, Prince of Prince, he was soon to become the Khan of what today Russia, the steppes, Kazan, and those areas. He's going to become a Muslim? No. Part of this misinformation, disinformation, lack of information is internal. And part has come from the outside. And its ultimate purpose is to deny you your own history. To deny you what you know. To deny you who you are. If nothing is carried back to the young people, you know, your children, grandchildren, know your history. Know the Quran, know the Sunnah, know your history. Know science. Know technology. Read the science outside. What happened was, Burhe Khan, or Baraka Khan, he was a highly spiritual prince. And he searched around. And I pointed out the last time, there was a competition by this time between the Christians and the Buddhists and the Muslims for the soul of the Mongol. The Christians sent not one, but five delegations to Karakoram to convert the great Khan. Two from the Vatican, one from the emperor in Constantinople, one from the Armenian king, and one from the Nestorians. And they also offered girls in marriage to them so as to have influence in the court. Dogus Khatun, for instance, was the chief wife of Kublai Khan, of the destroyer of Baghdad, Hulagu Khan. So this man is interested in spirituality. He asks around and he finds a seminary in Bukhara. The sheikh of the seminary was, it's very important for us to know the name, Saifuddin. Please remember the name, Saifuddin. How do we know that? Saifuddin is buried in the same compound as Imam Imam Bukhari, in the same compound as Imam Bukhari. And we had the privilege of visiting him. We were taken down to the very grave of Imam Bukhari. He's buried in that compound. And so that you remember, I'll give you some other facts too. Baba Farid, who most of you from Pakistan know, Baba Farid, before he came to India, studied at the seminary. And the great traveler Ibn Battuta writes about this great sheikh. So Baraka Khan went to the seminary, enrolled as a murid of the sheikh, and studied under him for 2 years. This was a Sufi sheikh, not a Salafi sheikh. Again, very loose terms. I'm trying to communicate the comprehensiveness of the knowledge that has come down to us from Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam through all of our Sahaba to us, and we say, no, we don't want it. You look at the bombings that take place. For what? No knowledge? Destruction of graves? What did the man who was buried there ever did to you? Is this Islam? It's a question mark. He studies there for 2 years. He learns the tenets of the tasawwuf, and there is transformation. You do not convert a person by force. No, it's not possible. He may say whatever you want to say, but he's not converted. You cannot convert a person by giving money. He will take your money and run away. It has to be a genuine transformation from within. People who listen to these men of faith, men of the spirit, and they were transformed from within, and they learned to say the inner meaning, understand the inner meaning of La ilaha illallah. Then he converts, he becomes a Muslim. 2 years later, he becomes the Khan of what is today Russia. And in 1258, 6 years after the acceptance of Islam by Baraka Khan, Baghdad is destroyed by Hulagu Khan. Hulagu Khan and Baraka Khan were cousins. Baraka Khan is upset because Hulagu Khan has not only destroyed Baghdad, he has destroyed the Islamic world, he has killed the Khalifa, and now he wants to destroy the Mamluks of Egypt and destroy the Mamluks of India and extirpate Islam. Go to Makkah and Medina, put an end to Islam. So he rises to the defense of Islam, and a civil war ensues as early as 1262 between Hulagu Khan and Baraka Khan. And the civil war was instrumental in enabling the Mamluks of Egypt to stand their ground after the Battle of Ain Jalut. I covered the Battle of Ain Jalut last week, 1263, where the Mongols were stopped. But Sultan Baybars did not stop at Jerusalem. He pursued the Mongols through northern Syria up to the western borders of Iraq. That was the beginning of conversion. But that was not enough for a total conversion. See, what happens is that when the chief becomes a Muslim or a Christian, whatever, other people copy him. So since Baraka Khan became a Muslim, his entourage, they accepted Islam. And there was a tug of war between the Christians and the Muslims and the Buddhists and the Shamanists for the soul of the Mongols, back and forth. If you read the conversion and reconversion, because there is the pull, and each side is trying to attract them to its side. The weakest one are the Muslims, because they have no political power in Central Asia or the Middle East, and yet they are triumphant. Ask yourself an independent question. Most of you are scholars, engineers, scientists, architects. Ask yourself this question. How do you change the heart of a person? Is it possible to catch a man in the street and tell him something? Is he going to become a Muslim? Come on. That was the profound transformation. You see, Islam, when submitted, presented with this innate spirituality, transforms people. How did the Sahaba accept Islam? It took the Prophet ﷺ 13 years in Makkah. He struggled for 13 years to transform the people of Makkah. And he had a handful of Sahaba. not millions, a handful of people. It doesn't happen that easily. Read about the conversion of Omar ibn al-Awwam. Read about the conversion of so many of the great Sahaba. The inner transformation. So after this consolidation of acceptance of Islam in the 13th century, you find that the civilization of Islam changes. A bend in the movement of the galactic motion of Islamic civilization in the 13th century between the years 1252 and 1303, when Ghazan the Great, the Ilkhan of Persia, that is today's Iran, accept Islam. Major bend. And they themselves become the champions of the new faith. The great Mughals who came to India, part Mughal, part Tatars, but Tatars are different people, but they themselves become the champions of new faith. A peaceful conversion from a situation of disadvantage. They're nothing, they're down there. And it did not happen through the professional ulamas. It did not happen because somebody went up there, camel driver, said, well, this is what I follow, so, oh, my prince, mighty prince, you follow me too. The profound transformation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the light that he gives to people within their hearts. That's how it happened. And then, if you look at Islamic history in the subsequent centuries, from the 13th to the 17th century, Islamic civilization is based upon tasawwuf. The great empires of the Mughals and the Safavids and the Ottomans were based upon tasawwuf. Most of the rulers of these kingdoms were followers of one or the other tariqas. I'll mention just one or two of them. Akbar the Great Mughal, he was an avid follower of Khwaja Muinuddin Chishti, of the Chishtiya order. The story is this, they are well known to some of you. Now he himself wanted to have a tariqa called Deen-e-Ilahi. It was misunderstood. They said he is trying to found a new religion. People who don't understand, give it a name. And he backed off. And of course, the subcontinent walked off in a different direction with the execution of Prince Dara Shikoh in the year 1659, if my memory serves me correctly. And India, which was at the time the most prosperous of all the kingdoms in the world, controlling 30% of the GDP of the world under Aurangzeb, went in a different direction. History took a turn. It moved from the east to the west. The civilization, Islamic civilization, that met the merchants of Europe was not a civilization based upon the tasawwuf. It was a civilization that had moved from taqwa to fatwa. It was a civilization of fatwa. You cannot transform a person giving him instructions. Take, for instance, somebody who smokes or drinks, common problems in America. You can tell him, hey, don't drink, don't drink, don't drink, don't drink. He may, for a time being, says, oh, my mom or dad, my brother or sister or son bugging me, I'm going to give up drinking. But the moment he sees some alcohol, like a hungry lion, he drinks it. Same thing with smoking. But you transform the heart of the person, he's transformed. He will give up whatever it is that he's doing, the evils. The transformation of the self that takes place only when you cleanse the heart through tazkiyah, through the remembrance of the name of Allah. When he's here, then there is no room for any evil. When he's not here, there is room for all the evils of the world. That is the message. The merchants of Europe met a civilization which had moved away from its spiritual legacy to the outward observances of the Sharia. And if you read the letters of Aurangzeb, for instance, written in 1707 to his son Muhammad Shah, in which he says something along the following lines, and this is the last quote that I will give you. He says to his son, oh my son, the light of my eyes. What can I say? My khutbah, that is the man responsible for taking care of thieves and so on and so forth, he himself is a thief. What can I say? My chief of staff, he's a drunk, he gets drunk at night. And my khazanchi, he steals money. And this 25 years after the promulgation of Futuwat Alamgiri, you cannot dictate, you cannot legislate morality. You can transform people, and when you transform people, they themselves make sure that morality is observed. Then that man becomes not just a good man, he may even become a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. He may become a star, a reflector of light, so that through his light, other people benefit, and they themselves transform themselves, and they come into the fold of Islam. Ask yourself how it applies to us today, in America, or in Canada, or India. India is a separate issue, and I'm not going to get into it. In America, for instance, how do we project Islam to people? Are we going to stand up and tell them, we have five principles? True, there's nothing wrong with it, it's true. But is that the face we want to project to them? We say prayer, they have prayer. We say fasting, they have fasting. We say charity, they give more, even more charity. Of course, we have the Hajj, they don't have the Hajj, but they have other kinds of pilgrimages. They do go to Jerusalem. No, it's not happening like that. But when you speak of the transformation, the Quran gives us guidance. That is, the transformation based upon service, worship, justice, knowledge, forthrightness, honesty, integrity. We have a chance. We have a chance to survive and to bring other people, expose them to the light of Islam. As to whether the transformation takes place or not, it's up to them. It's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who Allah guides, nobody can lead astray. And if Allah does not guide, nobody can bring the light. Let's now have a few minutes of 10 minutes of exchange of questions, answers, ideas. Yes, ma'am.
Just, I wanted to just kind of like tie everything in that you were speaking about. A few lectures ago, you talked about the great cities. And so you kind of explained how Mecca was more isolated and didn't kind of, because of the isolation, geographical isolation, it didn't foster maybe a lot of cross-cultural or cross-knowledge, whereas certain cities espoused more of that diversity of knowledge, and they even encourage different kinds of thoughts, like they encourage Hindus and Buddhists and Christians to come to these great cities. So some of the Sufis that you talked about, you know, and that you, were they all from these earlier kinds of cities? I mean, where did they emerge from, and kind of like, is it one source, or are they all over, or?
Great question, great question. The question is, among the lectures, it was pointed out that Mecca and Medina were cities in the heart of Islam, where cities like Kufa, for instance, were outlying areas which were melting pots, bringing people from Iran and India and Turkestan and Mongolistan and Iran and Yunnan, that is Greece. They would come in with their own questions and their own ways of looking at the questions of transcendence. They became melting pots. So the schools of fiqh that originated from Kufa, like Imam Abu Hanifa, were much more open for the accommodation of questions that they were facing at the time than the schools that rose up in Mecca and Medina, such as the Maliki fiqh. Maliki fiqh tends to be much more rigorous, much more, much tighter in terms of the leeway that gives a jurist. Now the question is, where did this awliya come from? The awliya were all over. As I read to you the names of these people, like Sheikh Shadhili. Sheikh Shadhili was from Cairo. Sheikh Abdul Khadir Jilani, he was from Baghdad. Maulana Rumi, he was born in Afghanistan, moved from there to Iran, finally settled down in what is today Turkey, and so on. These awliya, these people of the spirit, they lived in little small hamlets, and the Mongols passed them by. These are all fakirs, you know, they're no threat to us. So they passed them by. And it was out of these so-called fakirs that we see the light of Islam transmitted to the Mongols from all over, basically from Central Asia.
What was the Mongols, what was the intention to destroy the civilizations? Now, by the way, they came particularly in the Muslim world.
I covered that the last week. Okay. It was a geopolitics type of a situation. It started off.
Question?
Through. Question is, what was in, why did the Mongols destroy the Islamic world? Basically, it was a miscalculation on the part of Shah Muhammad of Khwarazm, who provoked Genghis Khan into conflict by killing his envoy. I went into the details of it. So it was a geopolitical miscalculation. And then, when the conflict started, the contrast between Genghis Khan and Shah Muhammad of Khwarazm, amazing. One is a masterful tactician, the other one is a coward who runs from city to city without giving battle to the Mongols, except for his one son, Jalaluddin, who turned around and faced him in what is today Afghanistan and what is today Pakistan, even in the Battle of Uttak, for instance. He gave him battle after battle. So that was the reason for it.
So, I know you don't like the term Sufism, but...
Let's use it anyway,
right? I know within Sufism there are different orders, right? Could you comment on that? I mean, are they region-based or the way they...
Very good question. There are different Sufi orders. Are they based upon region? The ultimate objective of the Tasawwuf and all the tariqah is the same. The transformation of the individual. So I often ask myself, you know, you read, for instance, a composition of Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani, you read a composition of Sayyidina Muinuddin Chishti and of Bahauddin Naqshband, and you see more of the same kind of language. So they have different approaches to arriving at the process of self-realization. Some of the ulama, some of the awliya, they emphasize transformation through zikr. Some emphasize transformation through a change of character. Some emphasize transformation through suhbat. So they had different approaches, and hence the tariqas. That's how they came out. It's commonly said there are 40 tariqas. I don't know how many there are. However, I should also say that just as extremism overtook Islamic world and decadence set in, same decadence also set in the schools of Tasawwuf. And this Piri Murudi became another way of making money. Mm-hmm. And it's, and the Sajjad al-Nashin becomes a millionaire. So we must be aware of that. As long as it is consistent with the Quran, accept it. If it is not consistent with the Quran, don't accept it. That's the message. Thank you for the question. Sir.
So you were saying the Mongols, those who converted, converted through Tasawwuf for the most part, was that correct?
Those who accepted, who accepted into the fold of Islam, did so through their contact with people of the Tasawwuf.
So did that trickle down to the rank and file Mongols?
Yes, it did.
As well?
Okay. Absolutely. When the king changes his fate, you know, his generals and everybody else, this is the way it used to be. You want to copy the king for multiple reasons. One, you want to keep your job. Secondly, you want to look good in the eyes of the king. Yes, yes, absolutely.
So not only they accepted Islam, they also accepted the sheikh of the leader.
Initially, yes. And hence for 400 years, from the year 1303 till the year 1684, Islamic civilization was driven by spirituality. That was a civilization that produced the Taj Mahal. That was a civilization that built the Masjid al-Lahore. The Registan of Samarkand, or the Blue Mosque of Istanbul. or the mosques in Timbuktu. Great period, absolutely great period. We said, no, we don't want it. We don't want it, you take it.
You have a question?
Sir.
go ahead from this young man.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, seriously.
Why is there a war with the Muslims weaker, and why was there a war?
Why was there a war? What happened was, see, the king, the Muslim king, he made a mistake. The Mongol king, he sent a person to trade, you know, he brought some things to sell. And the Muslim king thought, oh, he's not selling anything, he's a spy. And therefore, he misunderstood what it was. So he mistreated this man. And so the Mongol king was upset. And he says, well, if you're going to mistreat my man like that, I'm going to wage war on you. That's what happened.
Okay. That was a great question, by the way. That was one of my questions, too. When Baraka Khan, right?
Yes.
Am I pronouncing that right?
Yes, Baraka.
Baraka. Baraka, yeah.
Baraka.
When he became Muslim,
yes.
Then how long he lasted? Did he fought his cousin? Which was
my memory serves me right. I think he died somewhere around 1265 or something like that. I don't remember the date exactly. You can look it up.
And he did continue. I mean, his family or his
yes,
people around him. Did
his son was a devout Muslim, and it continued.
For how long? That's what I wanted.
It continued.
Until
the Russians in the 18th century under Peter, they conquered those areas. And
did he succeed at Allah Khan?
Did he
succeed Allah Khan?
Allah Khan was the Khan of what we consider today Iran, whereas Baraka Khan was the Khan of Eastern Russia, the area of Kazan, the area east of the Volga River, all the way to the Caspian Sea, which includes portions of Kazakhstan, Eastern Russia. It had become mostly Muslim until the 18th century, when the Russians forced them back into the fold of Eastern Orthodox Church. No, the two are cousins, mm-hmm. but different areas.
Different
areas. Remember, four different kingdoms, mm-hmm. China, Central Asia, Iran, and Russia.
Yeah, but who stopped Allah Khan just going further, because he had intention to go to Makkah and Medina and destroy it.
Yes. What happened was, Hulagu Khan was not in Baghdad at the time of the Battle of Anjalut. He had gone to Karakoram because there was a dispute regarding who was going to become the great Khan. When he came back, he got his army together. But at the time, Baraka Khan initiated hostilities against Hulagu Khan mm-hmm. and diverted his attention from attacking the Mongols in Egypt. That was it.
And also,
the India was also, they didn't attack India, right?
They did raids, but not the way they attacked the area which is in western Pakistan, no, up to the Indus River. Sir?
So you mentioned about Fatawa Alamgiri.
Fatawa Alamgiri, yes.
So you said it's a wrong move, or it has impact which is negative towards Islam?
No, not right or wrong.
Question?
The question is about Futuwat-e Alamgiri. Not right or wrong. It is a different approach, a difference in emphasis. It started with the execution of Darashikoh. Up until the time of Darashikoh, that is from Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan, and the latter part of Shah Jahan's life was in prison. But anyway, up until the time of Shah Jahan, Islamic civilization, and especially Indian civilization, Indian Islamic civilization, was based upon tasawwuf. That was the orientation. But with the advent of the Futuwat, which happened as a result of the enormous influence of the Naqshbandi Sufi order in the Mughal courts, And the profound and powerful writings of Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi of the Punjab, Islamic civilization changed its orientation, changed its direction. They said, we have gone too far in this direction. It's becoming non-compliant with the Sharia. So we got to get back to the Sharia. And he says, well, I'm going to impose the jizya, I'm going to pour it. He did all of that, we know. That's what I mean. Change in direction. And what I'm submitting to you is that you cannot transform people through edicts. You can have all the edicts in the world, you can write down all the legislation. You can compel people to do it. If there is fear of disobeying a law, people follow the law. But transformation of individuals takes place only from within. Only from the life, the transformation. Unless the transformation takes place, the person does not change his fate. That's my submission.
But what was the option, actually? Since they went too far, how can you bring a nation to a, at least the...
That's a very good question. That's a very good question.
Question?
What, how do you, you know, if the civilization had gone too far in one direction, how do you bring it back to the mean? That's a very good question. You know, if we live around the year 1684, and if we were lieutenants to the great emperor, what kind of advice would we give them? In my opinion, the elimination of Darashikwa itself set a chain of events into motion until the preparation and publication of the Futuwat. What are the options available at that point? The same question confronts us today. One can discuss them and debate them. One can say, well, if, for instance, the schools of Tasawwuf have gone too far outside of the Sharia, bring them back into it and not abolish them. Not go too far in the other direction. So it's a very good question. There is no single answer to it. Multiple answers can be given, and they can be debated. In hindsight, of course, we have the advantage of the hindsight. But if we lived at that time, what would we do? It's not an easy question. But the question was faced, a decision was made, civilization moved in the direction with appropriate consequences.
It's Isha time.
Okay. Isha time, sir? Yes.
Thank you.
One last question, and we'll call it a day. Yes, ma'am.
According to me, whether there are two prerequisites for it. There's we have to do ikhlas, and then must be a tiba, it means that imitate Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then you said that love cannot be taught. According to me, love can be taught, something that you really love. For example,
good question. There's a challenge from the sisters. As I said, love cannot be taught. And the sister is suggesting love can be taught. Well, if it can be taught, I stand corrected. I wonder if it can be taught. Because love is an attribute of the heart.
Yeah.
The heart either opens by will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or it does, even in ordinary things. You know, for instance, you look at young couples. You know, the man looks at the young lady, or the young lady looks at the man, they fall in love, and you say, how could that be? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened their hearts to it. So I still submit that it cannot be taught. But if my good sister feels it can be taught, maybe we can all learn.
because you know, if we love Allah, we want to meet Allah. It means that we would like to pray, whatever Allah explained to us, we would to follow. Or whatever our Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained to us, we have to do it.
Absolutely.
When our Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbid to do it, and then we don't do it. So it means that when we really love Allah, whatever Allah said, we follow.
That's true. Absolutely true. That's, as you said, the precondition is if we love Allah. If we love Allah, we don't say we love Allah. I would still caution my brothers and sisters, never say I love Allah. It's a big test. But Allah loves us, and He opens our heart. we follow his direction. Ati Allah wa ati Rasul wa ulil amri minkum. So we follow his commandments because Allah loves us, because he opened our hearts. As the Quran says very openly, whom Allah guides, there is guidance. If Allah does not guide someone, there is no guidance. So you're absolutely right, but if you have a recipe for teaching love, alhamdulillah, we will all learn from your good sister. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. By way of explanation, I think I will give only maybe three or four more of these sessions. Next week, inshallah, we'll cover the contributions of women queens in Islam, the development of so-called hijab from a historical perspective, or we can cover the introduction of Islam into Africa. Those are two. The third one is the impact of riba on world civilization and how it affected Islamic civilization. That's the third one. And the last one, I have to conclude with a summary of the marginalization from a historical point of view of Muslims, to how it happened, what were the main drivers of it. That will take us to the 10th of Shaban, and then we can call it quits for the time being. I hope you're thinking and thinking and thinking as we go, because the purpose of these sessions is not to communicate information. The purpose is to challenge and make you think and to integrate, because all of these are signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.